What is up? Welcome to the Wholesale Horror Stories, where we tell wholesale horror stories. What's up, guys? Welcome, welcome, welcome. Today we have an awesome guest here with us, Ryan Kane. And of course we have Jacob Simpson. Jacob Simpson is our co-host on this show. Holy moly, Ryan, we got into some really crazy, sticky situation, and we have a $60,000 assignment fee on the line. A bunch of crazy, like, questionable practices with this deal that we've gone through, and we're still fighting it with the lawyers, aren't we?
We are, 100%. Yeah. It's a rough battle, to be honest. It's a rough battle, but we're going to get through it. And like, long story short, I mean, we have everything in place. We did everything correctly. You know, there was no bad doing on our part. So there will be an end to the story for sure, which hopefully will be soon, because this is, I think we're creeping up on a year here. And the longest term, I think, was 18 months is what the legal told us. So.
Didn't they start by telling us like 3 months?
Though? They told us like 3 months. Yeah, 100%. They're like, oh, we'll get this done. Give us this deposit and we'll get it done. And then, you know, second meeting and they're like, oh, you know, it might take a little bit longer.
Yeah. So, bro, can you like paint the picture? So, of course, I have my side, but you are more heavily involved with like fixing it because you're just smarter than me. You have more patience than me. So can you like paint the picture for the audience from start to finish of like, how we got it? I guess I'll start with how I got it, and then 100%. I'll pass it to you, and then maybe pass it back.
Yeah, that's perfect. Yeah.
Okay, so to start this story off, I was cold calling on an auto dialer, just a random list of all the agents in Florida, and I come across this one agent, and she picks up the phone, and I'm like, "Hey, my name is Nathan, looking for fixer uppers, yada yada yada." Give her the whole spiel. She's like, "I have this opportunity in Brooksville." And I'm like, oh, really? What's the address? And I get the address from her. And keep in mind, this is the first time I called this agent. I get the address from her, and I have my buddy listening into my convo, and he's comping it as I'm talking to her. And I'm like, how much do you want? And she said a little over 400,000, and I offered 400. And she's like, we'll accept it. And I'm like, huh? Like that quickly, that easily? I just called you. This is the first time I called you. And you accept, I'm like, this is a home run. Like, and I found out that the reason why they said they'll accept it so quickly is because the husband of the realtor was the power of attorney for this property. And the realtor was double ending it. And she's like, boom, a good offer. Let's take it. So I put it under contract. I start marketing it. I reach out to a bunch of dispo wholesalers, Ryan being one of the dispo wholesalers. And Ryan ends up, oh, look at those fireworks. I got to turn those gestures off. Ryan ends up being the wholesaler that brings me a buyer on it. So Ryan, when you brought me a buyer, you want to like take over from there and tell me what it was like on your side?
Yeah, 100%. So I mean, me and one of my best friends, we've been, you know, we flipped houses before together, and we've also done some wholesaling together, not much, but mainly what he does is fix and flip. So I brought it to him right away. You know, obviously we saw that it was a deal. And actually, Nathan, if you remember, I was like anxious on, I was like, yo, I was like, I need a contract right now.
Dude, I had another person like ready to go.
Yeah.
And you're like, bro, like, come on. Like,
I need this.
With you though, dude. Like,
well, we live an hour away. Right. So like one thing that I have over a lot of people in the general area is just that I live here. Right. So like, obviously I know a lot of local realtors and just a lot of people in real estate. So like, we knew that the ARV of the home was probably around 750, and just due to the fact of who the owner was, it was still a really great house. It just needed a little bit of cosmetic repairs, you know, some lipstick. So we knew that there was, you know, a six figure profit on the back, and it didn't start with a one, you know? So that's pretty much how that got started. You know, and then we found out the details, right? That's one huge thing that I think that we should talk about is all right. So the seller, the reason why they had power of attorney over the seller is because he was in jail. Okay. So like career, criminal, you know, just a bunch of charges, like goes on for lists and lists.
I remember looking him up and it was like DUI. Yeah. I think it was like an decent exposure or something, maybe.
Yeah. I mean, abuse, animal abuse.
bro, that was crazy, dude. Their dog, like, oh my god, yeah. The agent was telling me, I think it was the agent that was telling me, the dog was like skin and bones, and yeah. There was like the girlfriend living in the trailer out front because yeah. It was like freaking cockroaches was, or head bugs or whatever.
Or, yeah, like fleas or something.
Dude.
It was wild. So, okay. All right. So we get it under contract. We're good to go. Right. Obviously we go through hard money and they need to do an appraisal. Okay. So I go out there for the first time. It's in like the middle of nowhere, right? Like cell phones barely work. And,
this is like just to paint the picture, guys, this is a little McMansion. This is like the biggest house on the block, huge lot, like bougie, like 2010 bougie style. But run down, like, as it, like, bro, it was like, it looked like they had a bunch of hookers in there, like the mattresses everywhere. Like,
yeah, like the only way to comp this house was doing it by zip code. I swear to you. Like, it was the largest house in the area. You couldn't really, you know, do it that way. And also, it's Hernando County. So, like, all the surrounding land, because it's technically like a lot of people own farms or just a couple acres there, you know, like, they don't sell, you know, it's generational. They're passing it down to their kids. So like finding an actual ARV on it was really tough. And I think that that's why a lot of people kind of strayed away from it, but we knew it was a deal from day one. Right. So we ordered the appraisal. Obviously I'm familiar with it. So I go out there, I put all my comps together, you know, the scope of work, everything that we're going to do to it so that we can hopefully get that ARV to make sure lending goes through properly. So we give them a heads up that, the girlfriend that's living on the property in the trailer out back, we give her a heads up that we're coming, and I get there, right? And so 5 minutes before the appraiser goes through, I walk through the house, I meet the girlfriend out back, and she's like, well, we're not selling the house. And I was like, what do you mean you're not selling the house? You know? And she's,
we have a contract. Like, you can't just,
not only do we have a contract, but you don't, you're not his wife. Like, you have nothing to do with the contract, you know? So, you know, she's like, we're not selling, da, da, da. And I was like, listen, I was like, at the end of the day, I was like, can you just be cordial and let me at least finish this? I already paid for this woman to come out, right? Like, just let me do my thing. She's like, all right, yeah, no problem. Okay. So as soon as the appraiser gets there, I go to go up to the front door and the door's locked now. Okay. So I'm like, oh, I know exactly what's going on. Like this, you know, this woman. Okay. And then, so I walk around the back. I try to open the slider door. It's not happening. So I walk around the other side of the house. I finally found a window that was open. Okay. So I open the window. I crawl through the window and then go to the front, open up the house. And mind you, like you said, like it's full of cockroaches, fleas, like it just smells, you know, like cat urine, like just the worst. Okay. There's stains all over the carpet.
If you're looking for a dispo partner, you want to pre-vet your dispo partner by how far to get the deal done.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, 30K in you know, less than 30 days, I'll probably do about anything, you know?
30K each, right? Like 60K total.
Yeah. 60K, yeah, exactly. You know? So I finally get this, you know, it open, everything's good to go. The appraiser goes through, you know, a few days later, appraisal comes back as it should. And then it starts to unravel on the back end between the agent, between you, between me and everything else, you know? So they're trying to back out of the contract. And what I would say is I'll pass it back to you real quick, because if you want to go over, like just the details of how they were trying to back out, essentially, you know what I mean? Like that they really couldn't because they didn't know, you know?
Yeah. So the way I understand it is, I went to the agent, or I guess the agent called me. Somehow the agent and I had a conversation that they no longer wanted to proceed with the property. But it's like, look, we have full rights to purchase this property. And there was a bit of tension because the power of attorney, the agent's husband. So just to structure the deal for you guys so you understand. So we have an agent that is double ending it. Then we have the agent's husband, that's the power of attorney for the dude that's in jail. And then we have the crackhead girlfriend living in the trailer out front. Okay.
Yep.
Now, the guy that was in jail, apparently he no longer wanted to sell it to us, even though the power of attorney already signed on his behalf. Yeah. So they ended up having that conversation with me. They're like, we no longer want to sell it to you. And it's like, what do you mean? Like, this is a done deal. Like, we already signed and everything. I got a little bit nervous, and immediately I went to go file an affidavit of memorandum. And what an affidavit of memorandum is it clouds title. It goes to, you go to the city and you say, hey, I have equitable interest. I have a right to purchase this property, and anybody else that tries to purchase this property can no longer buy it unless if they fix this situation. So a couple days went by, and then I was speaking with title, and title says, hey, you know, we just called a lender for a payoff. The lender said that another title company just called them for a payoff. So what does that mean? Well, that means that another title company is doing title work on this file, on this property. So that was sketchy AF. And it was like, I think like a 3-day period where like title was dodging my calls. I literally called them like 12 times in a day, and they were dodging them. And then finally they get on the phone with me, and title's like, we don't want to underwrite this, which pretty much means we don't want to proceed with this transaction. And the reason why the title company didn't want to proceed with the transaction was because of how sticky it was. Agent was double ending it. Power of attorney is the agent's husband. Dude's in jail. Dude no longer wants to sell. We find out that the dude is signing contracts in the jail. Bro, he's literally in the jail signing other people's freaking business and sale agreements. So this is kind of like where I'll pass it back to Ryan, because I brought this information to Ryan, and then Ryan responded accordingly.
Right. Yeah. Before you jump into that,
do you all know if you had specific performance or a clause within your contract that states that you can go after specific performance?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
Well, then, you should be good.
Yeah, no, we are good. Trust me, I'm getting this out.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The specific performance is where it's like we had a deal one time where an attorney, we got into it with another real estate attorney. She was the owner. I think I told the story on here before, but she basically, we were making $106,000 assignment fee split 50-50, and we knew that she was a real estate attorney. So the person that I was working the deal with was also a real estate attorney. So they jumped on the phone together, did their real estate talk, and they put a giant clause in the provision specifically for specific performance. And then they both signed off on it. So I was like, what does this even mean? And he explained it to me, and he was like, it basically means that we don't have to double close. And if she has an issue with that $106,000, we can sue her for that $106,000. And she has no right to do anything other than give it to us.
Well, kind of like you could force the closing, right?
You can force the sale. Either you force the sale, or she owes you that $106,000. One of the two.
Kind of like at the mercy of the title company. In this scenario, we're at the mercy of the title company, because seller obviously is not going to sign an amendment to change the title company. The title company is like, we're out. Like, we don't want to do this.
Yeah. All the title companies were scared. I have a buddy here in Tampa. He was like, oh, I'll take it on. No problem. You know? So we had everything in place. But just to give you a little bit more details about how skeevy these people were. So not only were they double ended at 8% commission. Okay. So let me actually explain it like this, right? So when we're going through and they're like, hey, we don't want to go through with the deal, mind you, we're already past due diligence. Like, we're, our EMD is already in, and 10K
hard EMD.
At 10K hard from day one. Right. So I was like, listen, I was like, I'm going to go out there. Like, you know, she was the girlfriend was nice at the beginning, you know, so I'm just going to at least try to go talk to her. Right. Cause like, honestly, if it's a thing about price, like, we're making so much in so many different ways that it doesn't matter. You know what I mean? Right. We can figure it out. So I go out there and I'm like, hey, what's going on? So she tells me this crazy story about how not only do they have the commission on it, but they also took title to his, you know, some big Duramax diesel truck as collateral for, you know, for the expenses that they were putting out for like marketing and everything, bro. And then also they're like, he stole 6 of our dirt bikes and, you know, a bunch of other stuff. And I'm like, hey, I'm like, well, this has nothing to do with me. Like, this is the people that you technically employed, you know? you know, so it goes back and forth. Like, this girl is just, you know, screaming at me. I'm on her property line in Hernando County, by the way. So
is
I don't
she
know.
She on drugs at the time? Like, do you think that she was
100%, 100%. That more details on the drugs is going to come later, because the agent,
the agent
is wild, bro. Right. So long story short, during that same time, right, because I have my guy in Tampa working on title. That's when we found out. They're like, hey, there's another title company that's going. So right away, you know, Nathan goes and files the memorandum. We start to get legal involved from the beginning, just because we kind of can see where it's going, right? So we put an end to that sale that was going on. Long story short, we called the other title company. They're like, oh yeah, this is rough. We don't want anything to do with it. So we stopped it right then and there. Okay. So then we still have to deal with closing on the property and making sure that
this too, to call the other title company and let them know, like, yo, this is a mess. So you can close on it, but have fun.
Well, there's going to be a title claim right away. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. 100%.
I'd rather go after your title insurance than the house, but that's here nor there. You know, but anyways, you know, so all of that happens. And then in the meantime, like, now the power of attorney is afraid to sign closing docs because of the fact that he got an email from the guy from jail saying, hey, like, I don't want to do this, right? So even though technically he had power of attorney, and power of attorney is you cannot revoke it unless it's like signed with a notary, and like there's a bunch of steps, right? You can't just cancel it over a text or call unless it's physically in that contract. Okay. Mm-hmm. Which obviously it's not. So I'm like, all right, I'm like, you know what? I'm like, what's the next step? Right. Like, let me go visit this guy in jail. Right. So
bro, get your municipal partner like Ryan. Ryan went into the house, unlocked it, dealt with crackheads, dealt with like thieving real estate agents. Bro, went to the jail and met up with the seller in jail. Like, I can't think of a dispo partner that wouldn't go that far. That would be able to meet that.
I mean, like I said, at the time, I mean, like, we were just like, I mean, at least I was just starting, and I was like, hey, like, this was my first deal, technically. You know what I mean? Like, that's a good start, right?
So it was like before you're like
a learning experience,
how to structure these contracts.
Yeah. I was like 3 weeks into Astro, I swear to God. And I didn't know anything about contracts. Yeah, you're right, bro. I didn't know anything.
Bro, it's crazy. Like, fantastic jump right there from like 3 weeks before you're like, hey Nate, what kind of contracts am I supposed to use on this one? And just taking massive action to like now you're getting into this like whole complicated sketchy scenario and handling it accordingly.
Yeah, well, I mean honestly, I like, in my view, like, it's better that it happened that way than it just have gone straight through, because, you know, then we probably would have had a little bit of a little ego behind us going into the next few of them, you know. And, now, like, this one, it was like, you know, like, we learned our lesson almost, but in a good way, you know. So so my next thing is I gotta go visit this guy, right? So like me and Nathan become online detectives because we have to figure out his birthday, we have to find out a bunch of stuff. So we're like on scrubbing Facebook, scrubbing county records, like absolutely everything. So I finally find out all the information. I call the jail. They're not supposed to give you like the inmate's number, but I explain to the lady like what's going on, and I'm like, listen, I really need to talk to this guy. So she gives me the inmate number verbally over the phone. Okay. And, and one other thing I want to add is that not only do we have the power of attorney, but they also have the county recorded call of him agreeing to that sale price. So that was like way before. Right. But so I get the docket number, I get everything, and I send him a friend request through Hernando County, you know, website. Okay. Cause he has to add you onto his list in order to have you go, right? So I was like, listen, I sent like $10 into his phone line thing so that he can call me. And I was like, listen, I need you to call me, just accept the friend request. So he calls me.
Bro,
like,
if you sign this, I'll give you some commissary. I'll send you $100 to sign this shit right now.
$100 every week till you get out. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Like, I don't even care.
Squares.
Yeah. So, and then, so he finally, I get him on the phone, long story short, and he's like, yeah, he's like, fine, like, you can come in, right? So I make the appointment. You have to show up and you have to go through a bunch of stuff. So, and you're sitting there like in front of like a TV screen, you know, and it's just a voice call. I had brought in like the contracts and everything to show him. They're like, you can't bring any of that in. And I'm like, oh, perfect. So, So I end up talking to him, you know, and he kind of breaks down that, you know, he needs a certain amount because, mind you, beyond all of the stuff that's going, is he also owns like $100,000 in fees to like the county and the court for all the time that he's done. Okay. Oh, so like that's a completely different aspect of like why he wanted the most amount of money. Okay. So we're like, listen, like me and Nathan went back and forth. We were like, listen, like we'll give you like 420. We're each going to take a 10K haircut. Right. And so we started mulling that over. He was like, yeah, he was like, honestly, he was like, that should work. Da 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 da. And I'm like, all right, perfect. I walk out of there feeling like $1 million. I'm like, yeah, we're closing this. Like, let's get it done. And then I get a call from his girlfriend, right? And she's like, we're not selling it.
Oh my God.
So then I call the agent, and the agent's like, oh, she was like, I know what will fix her. She was like, I had videos from their old roommate of them strung out on drugs. You know, so this agent now is sending me videos. Of them videos. And honestly, it's like, it's funny like to talk about, but like, if you actually watch them, it's like, oh my God, you know, it's like, yeah. Like there's just, you know, kind of zombied out, zonked out, paraphernalia everywhere. And, you know, just like a rough situation, you know? So long story short, I mean, from there, then, you know, we know what's going on. They're still trying to sell it. We get wind of another cash buyer for $375 cash, obviously without the broker, without anything like that. So we were working through that. We got an end to that one as well. And so as of right now, we've been in court in the legal process for about a year. We're about $25,000 into legal fees, which technically based off the contract, he's also liable for, right? Also, one of the crazier things is that he doesn't even live at the house anymore, right? So technically it's still in his name, but there's somebody else. So I don't know if he rented it or maybe he did like a lease to like a rent to own. Like, we don't actually even know the situation, right? We've summoned them a million times and they find him every single time because the attorneys have private investigators. And last time I heard, he was in like Delisle, Florida. I've never.
So he got out of jail now?
He's out. He got out the day we were supposed to close, actually.
Oh, yeah.
Because it was a situation to where he had so much in the past, they didn't know if they were going to let him out or extend his sentence. And they did let him out. Yeah. So what's taken the legal process so long is that it takes so much time for them to find him in between each time that they have to serve him. Yeah. And he ended up, he made one appearance and he answered like one, you know, one of their notifications. And it's literally like crayon and white paper, like handwritten, like, you know, it's not like typed out or anything. It's just like, this has nothing to do with me, da, 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 you know? So here's the two options that we're going for, you know, is like at the end of the day, like we want the house because of the value that's in it. Right. But at the same time, if we don't get the house, like we want the title insurance, you know what I mean? We want the title insurance for all of the money, the profit on the front end, the profit on the back end. You know what I mean? All the money that we've essentially put into it at this point and like lost time, you know,
because like didn't it end up closing for $375 though to the other buyer? Or like what happened with that? I don't think I got
yeah. So, well, so that's the thing, right? Is that so like it's such a weird situation because, and like, I'm not a lawyer, right?
But just to get some context for the people, remember the affidavit of affidavit of memorandum that I filed, the thing that's supposed to prevent it from closing. I remember what had happened is the city had a backlog.
Yeah.
And even though I got that document to the city in a timely manner, it wasn't uploaded online in a timely manner. Right. So do you have more info on the, on it? Like, cause I think we saw it like close at and we were like, what the heck?
So it was technically sold, right? But the thing is that it wasn't a sale, it was a quiet deed claim to a trust that like apparently the attorneys found out that it was somebody that he knew. Okay. Mm-hmm. So they're trying to do their due diligence on the back end to see if it was an actual sale or if it was just something to you know, to get debtors off of his back, essentially. Because also one thing that we forgot, if you remember, is that on top of that commission, they had taken like a payday loan against equity on the home, if you remember. Mm-hmm. So for like $7,500 they got paid, they owe like 3 or 5% to this payday loan company on top of the brokerage fee.
Yeah, this shit was like a shark. Jeez.
Yeah, I mean, like bunch of sharks. And like, honestly, like we just were in a position to where it just kind of got handed on our lap. And then we were trying to figure out, you know, the situation. Like, it's he said, she said, the sellers are now saying that they're going to sue the broker and like all this other stuff. And we're like, listen, like, I have nothing to do with that. You know what I mean? I met this lady over a phone call, you know, like, I'm just trying to buy the house, you know? But yeah, so, and then, like I said, I touched base with the attorneys yesterday. So what they said was that they're pushing for a motion to where they don't need him to, they don't need him to respond. Okay. So that essentially they can just go for it. They can either get the house or they can go for the title insurance, you know, cause we'll, at this point, like we'll take anyone, obviously like we want the house, but I mean, if they're just going to kind of fork us out some cash as well, like that wouldn't be too bad, you know? I mean, at this point, like mentally I've written it off, you know, like I'm still dealing with it, but like, I'm not, obviously we're not counting that cash anytime soon. So.
Dude, I remember when I was calling you like every 2 weeks, any updates?
Yeah.
Now it's like, I'm just going to wait.
Every 6 months. Yeah. Every 6 months we're like, hey, what's going on? You know, it's just a rough process, you know? And I think that at least like educational wise, like this, it's a great story to tell, to like, let people know like what actually can happen, you know, like just because you have it under contract doesn't mean it's closed. You know what I mean? Like that's the biggest thing. And you can have a million other things happen. So like since then I've had probably 3 or 4 other buyers back out that I'm under current list pendants in litigation right now. Like, it always happens to be the best deals, right? Every single time, you know, cause you know, there's probably 20 people, other people calling them and you know, this, that, and the other thing. And they, by the time that you're going to close, like they know the value, if that makes sense, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's my story, my friend, or our story.
Bro, that transaction has been wild. I actually got some updates here that I didn't have before. Holy moly, bro. And I agree, you know, the learning to this transaction was something that people will pay $10,000 for easy, just to learn all of those things. I learned so much. The affidavit of memorandum was a really, really great thing that I learned, like just how to go through that process, file it. You know, I learned like acknowledge the red flags immediately, right? Power of attorney. Okay, let's get an understanding. Why is there a power of attorney? What's going on here? If you get a deal immediately after cold calling a random agent, like even though you might think like, woohoo, I'm really lucky, like red flag, what's going on? Why was it so easy?
Yeah. If they say yes right away, there's probably something going on.
You know? Yeah.
Like that's how it is. And also like one other thing is like it was one of the things that made it a mess is like the brokers themselves. So like definitely watch who you're doing business with. Right. Because like most of these people are sharks and they don't care about you at all. Like that's one thing, like no offense to, you know, the people who are watching or the people that are realtors, but you know, a good portion of the realtors that are out there, like they're just out there for the check, you know, and like they're going to be friendly to you and make sure, you know, tell you the world, especially on like ARV and everything, you know, but obviously everybody's out for their own pocket, you know, so
I was gonna say, unfortunately, that's business. I mean,
most people,
you know, most people do try to collaborate and they do try to give back, but I know firsthand people who preach collaboration
and I we've had other situations. So like, you guys know, I do like luxury flips and new builds and stuff now. So like I even have a different situation in Florida to where we had this deal under contract, right? It was insane house, bro. It was $3.5 million purchase price. ARV was like $9 million or something. It was going to cost $1.5 to $2 million to build, 24 month process. Okay. So when I raised the capital for a lot of that, right? So when we got the terms back from the lender, it was like $1.7 million we needed to close. And like at that point, it's like, hey, we could do like 4 or 5 other smaller homes, you know what I mean? And during that same process. So we're like, hey, listen, like maybe we're biting off more than we can chew, right? So mind you, like we have $100,000 at escrow during this time, right? So we cancel 2 days before 2 days before inspection is up, right? And they're like, you know, they're like, oh, they're like, well, let us know when we can release the EMD to the seller. And I was like, what are you talking about? Release the EMD to the seller. Okay.
The title that said that or the agent?
What was that?
Was that title that said that or the agent?
It was title, right? And we found out it was based off of the contract, right? So we were kind of moving quickly, and my partner was the one that facilitated the front end of it. And mind you, he's from California. So like to his knowledge, right, Florida state law is that you, as long as you cancel with an inspection, right, you're fine. You get the EMD back, right? But what had happened is, number one, after checking with legal, is that that's not Florida state law. It's just assumed to be Florida state law.
Right? Yeah, you have to have mutual signatures.
Well, and it also it's based off of like an as-is FAR bar contract, right? Mm-hmm. So we realized after that that she, it's in Naples, I'll just put it that way, okay, it's in Naples, and they have like their own county contract, okay, and that's different from an as is FAR bar. Okay.
Oh, did the switcheroo on.
Right. Now, mind you, like since this happened, we've purchased another home with her, so now like we're in a situation like that's different, you know. But but long story short, like, it literally stipulates in there that in order to cancel during inspection, get your EMD back, like you have to have a reason, like an inspection report, like, and everything, almost as if you were doing like a traditional transaction, right? Virginia. So, right. And I mean, long story short, it all came down to the fact that like my partner didn't read it, you know what I mean? Like, or didn't check with like legal. He thought it was a FAR bar as is, like I said, cause he's from California, and it is what it is, you know what I mean? Like, so now we're in another battle for that that amount. I mean, it was our money, so it's not a crazy, I mean, it's a big deal, but you know what I mean? But I'm like willing to bet that we're lucky to probably walk away with half of it as far as settlement goes.
That's why, like, I mean, it backfires on me sometimes, but I don't put EMD up anymore until the inspection is complete because of that exact reason. Like,
I get you.
Yeah, like we have a deal right now. Well, my EMDs are also like 10 grand, like 5,000 to 10 grand. But like I've had multiple occasions where the sellers are like, hey, we're not signing a release and we've canceled within the inspection period. And if I put my EMD in there, I would never see my EMD.
Yeah.
Like right now, I've been waiting for 10 grand EMD for 14 months now on one of my deals.
Yeah. That's right. Where's it located?
That one is DC.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I can't
help. Yeah. I've never seen that EMD.
In DC, those contracts, they require an inspection report to cancel, correct?
Yeah. So it's the same situation.
Not in DC, but in Virginia, they do. Oh, Virginia. Gotcha. So in DC and Maryland, it says that the inspection can be done by the buyer. And I've gotten out of so many inspections this way because they're like, you didn't submit the inspection report. I'm like, go read your contract. I don't need to. But in Virginia, it clearly says that if you cancel, you have to submit the inspection report. It doesn't say you have to disclose why you're canceling. You just need to submit the inspection report and tell them you're canceling, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, crazy situation, you know, but one of the main reasons why we put up like a large amount of EMD is just because, to be completely honest, is like because of wholesalers, right? So I think that there's a big push for luxury right now because, you know, people are waking up and seeing that you really can like hit crazy spreads, 5-figure, 6-figure spreads on luxury. So like, it's a big rush to it right now, you know? So like, I'm in the same, it's like what the experienced wholesalers deal with single family homes, you know, like Jacob and Nathan, like you guys will call an agent, you know, and you guys are getting outbid by, you know, newer wholesalers, you know, and it's just like the EMD is a lot higher, stuff like that. So like, we're just in a position, I mean, we're closing on the property ourselves, you know what I mean? So it's just like, listen, like I'm willing to, like, I know that if I put 100K to 225 EMD or something like that, then they're like, I'm a serious player. You know what I mean? I mean, at that point, it's just making sure that everything's on a FAR bar and that you can cancel within your inspection period.
Read your contracts.
Yeah. You know? So, I mean, it's a crazier thing. Cause like that same agent is supposed to sell the house that we're doing right now. So like, we have to kind of figure out a deal with her where it's like, yo, like you got to kind of take this hit with us. You know what I mean? We were kind of like relying on you to make sure everything was on the up and up, you know? And it's like she could have put it on a FAR bar at the beginning, but she just chose not to, you know, she chose to use that contract. And now we're in the situation that we're in, you know? Mm-hmm. So like I said, like it is what it is, but these people and the sellers, man, right? Not only are they going to come up, you know, somewhere 50 plus, okay? They also put it on market right after we canceled the contract for a month and then took it off market right away. So I don't know what the situation is, but
I wonder if they can sell it without releasing your EMD.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. Because it's not like a
list. I don't know because here's the thing. If there's no cancellation signed, if there's a dispute over the EMD, then there's no cancellation, which means you're still in contract. I've actually got my EMD back from this before. So we sent an EMD. The seller refused to sign the release. They listed it back on the market. It went under contract with a new buyer. They decided to be petty and reach. I let it go at this point. I just took the loss. It was like $2,500. I was like, whatever. Yeah. They decided to be petty and email me and title and basically be like, hey, did Jacob get his EMD back? We just want to make sure you're still holding it. And so I was like, okay, hell no. Like, y'all want to do this? Like, let's see where we can go then. So I basically called the listing agent. She didn't answer. So then I called the seller. I talked to the seller. I said, hey, is there any way we can work this out? He said, who are you? And then I explained who I was. And he goes, screw you. I don't want anything to do with you. Give me my money. Hung up the phone. Or before he hung up the phone, I was like, all right, cool. If that's how we're going to handle it, I'm going to see you in court. And he goes, excuse me. And I was like, I don't know if your agent is misleading you, but go read the contract and you're going to be paying for my attorney fees. I will see you in court. And I hung up the phone. Then I called the list, the buyer's agent who had the deal under contract to buy it, called the buyer's agent. I said, hey, are you the buyer's agent on this transaction? He goes, yes. And I was like, I hate to tell you this, but I'm still in contract with your client. They're refusing to sign a release. So until that release is signed, I'm still technically the one who's under contract with this. So I either recommend that you call your listing agent and have them sign the release immediately so you can close on this transaction, or you can go tell your buyer to kick rocks because I will take this to litigation. And I promise you, you're not buying this house. Yeah. Literally within 10 minutes. Hey, Jacob, we're sending the cancellation over now. I didn't know you. Sorry. Like, it was just a bunch of nonsense.
Yeah.
The meaning is, from my understanding with title and what the title company and everyone had told me, that it's actually like, unless, so at least up here, there's two boxes you can check on the release. The first box is saying that the money's going to which party. The second box is saying that you're releasing each other, but the EMD can still be disputed.
Mm-hmm.
If you didn't sign that though, then there's no release signed. And that means you're still under contract with them until a release is signed. So unless that release is signed, I would definitely call that listing agent who brought that deal and be like, hey, I just want to let you know, like, I saw it go on market. I saw it get taken down. You know, if this sells, this is going to be another lawsuit. And technically we're still under contract.
100%. I think that that's part of the reason why they took it off market, to be completely honest, is because the way that they're looking at it is like they're trying to come up the full 100,000, you know, so they're like little quick rip of 100 and then put it on market and sell
put it
and,
back on.
Market, I mean, it had been on the market. It had been on the market for a while. You know what I mean? It's like, I mean, how many people are really buying, you know, a 2,800 square foot house for $3.5 million? You know, like it's a guarantee. You have to knock it down. You know what I mean? And build a new one to make money. You know, Jacob, you want to go under contract for me? No, I'm joking.
Bro, yeah. Dude, it's funny. We, me and this other kid, he brings me an off market wholesale property at 105, and we shop it like crazy. We had like, some people said 50, most people said 30 plus buyers show up. Like it was hot. And we had a buyer locked in at 144. And then title started doing their work and they found out that there was a bankruptcy in the past with these sellers. So these sellers were under the impression that because they filed bankruptcy, they were no longer liable for the debt that they accumulated. But what actually that meant was if they ever sold their assets in the future, that debt needs to get paid back. So the sellers were under the impression they were going to clear a quick like 100K-ish. Once they found out that they weren't going to clear 100K-ish, bro, they literally just straight up ghosted us.
They're like, we're not selling. This is
done. Yeah.
exactly, bro. But it's like, we had
to rent it.
Had everything lined up. Like, we had it under contract for 105. There was like about $112,000 in debt. We were gonna just take the haircut to get it closed, but they just ghosted us. They're like, we'd rather like hold the house and not sell. So
yeah,
what can you do?
Yeah. So yeah. I mean, the saying goes, right, for wholesaling, especially, like, we get paid for the problems we solve. And man, do we have to deal with some wild problems sometimes?
And negotiate the lender down, but they wouldn't take our calls. We managed to indirectly get through to them, but they still like, they would refuse to like give us the attorney's the lender's number to reach out to them, because we were gonna call the lender and be like, hey, look, right now you're out, like, you're not making anything. You want to make something? Let's negotiate.
Nathan's calling a bank, a hedge fund, literally. He's like, we gotta talk. It's like, I really got to make this $20,000, you know?
Yeah.
No, I love that though. You know what I mean? I mean, one thing, I don't know if you guys have seen it, but like with me being in the lending space, I've seen lenders start cracking down on like assignment fees actually. Right. So like a lot of, if somebody's using hard money, I've seen a lot of lenders put like an 8% or 10% cap, you know, based off of purchase price on the properties. I mean, and there's a great, like a really, really great lender, and they give great terms based off of experience. Right. So they'll do 90% LTV, and they'll roll in the payments. Right. So like, you literally need to come with like a penny comparatively to, you know, if you were to use other lending, but they're like, they max out their assignments at like $45,000, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like, if you're doing
that up here,
what is it?
Our lenders have been doing that up here. They won't. So yeah, it depends on the lender, to your point. But a lot of lenders will now, especially in my market, because people are just super greedy, and they'll just, so another thing I'm learning too, but a lot of times you have big assignment fees up here. Like, I've seen 60, 100K clips. I've seen 200K clips. And so lenders are like, whoa, 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 like, hold on. So to your point, they're putting in like no more than 15, 20% of the actual purchase price. But the other thing I learned, which I didn't know about, and I just learned this about a month or so ago, a lot of the underwriters, so there's like two nationwide underwriters, I forget who it is. They are known for being able to to ensure the whole assignment price and contract price. So like, if you get a property at 500,000, and you sell it at 600,000 or assign it at 600, they'll insure the full 600. Most underwriters will only insure the contract price. Yeah. So like most, and so like, I talked to my title company and they're like, no, we only do the contract price. And I think that's another reason lenders are shying away from it, because they're like, well, hold on. If we're lending 600 grand and only 500,000 of it is insured, that's 100 grand that could just go missing, and then I'm not covered on that by any means.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is probably a pretty good liability.
Yeah. You know, cause it, like you got to understand too, like these big companies, like, they're lending to strangers, you know, based off of experience that can be altered. You know what I mean? Like, they can always change. Like, there's a million things that you can do to make it look like you have all the experience, you know?
Yeah. Add yourself to somebody's LLC, sit in the background.
Yeah, I mean, you can. I mean, it's illegal, but you can change operating agreements from previous flips. I mean, there's literally like a million things that you can do, and it's obviously it's super illegal. You know what I mean? So it's like, is it really worth going to jail over trying to get a better rate? You know what I mean? Like, let's be real here. You know,
it's crazy the amount of stuff people will do. I had someone send me a deal one time, and I refused to send it out. They sent me a deal. And they were like, hey, can you market this property for me? And they sent me the contract. And in their contract, they included their proof of funds. It was a bank statement. Well, they had edited their dollar amount, but they did it poorly. So it said like $750,000, but there was four zeros after the comma. So 750 and then comma 0000. So they had added an extra zero. Somehow the agent didn't catch it.
Dude, they could have at least done the inspect element on Chrome and just edited the code and then took
it. No, that's what they did, but they put 750,000. So they added an extra zero and they printed that out and sent, or they took the screenshot and sent that in. Yeah. The agent accepted it. They sent it to me and I was like, yo, bro, what as much this? As I'd love to market this, there is literally a document attached to it that's for like blatantly showing that you're committing fraud.
Yeah.
Like I cannot. Like,
oh, the bank missed a comma, I swear. You know? Like.
Yeah, yeah. So I was just like, bro, like you got to do better, man. Like,
yeah. It really is crazy, man. It really, really is crazy. And like, I'm not going to touch on it too much, but it all leads back to even like the people with their own funds. You know what I mean? Like the funds are popping up like every other day right now. It's like, you don't even know these people. You know what I mean? Like you really don't know their experience. You don't know anything. Like you don't even know where your money's going. You know,
right.
I had a buddy call me. Right. So this is a good story. This is like not a wholesale horror, but so, I have a buddy who he was sitting on like, close to $1 million in cash. Right. And he's trying to disperse it and kind of be like a gator lender type situation. Right. So, and mind you, he's built houses in the past. Okay. So he calls me and he's like, hey, he was like, I have this great deal. He's like, it's 640. I'm going to lend them in 90 days. They're going to get me back, 20 or 30%. Okay. And I'm like, oh, I'm like, that sounds great. I'm like, what are they doing? He's like, they're rehabbing a multifamily and the ARV, like purchase price was 640. ARV was like 1.1. Right. And I was like, wow, that sounds great. I was like, but I don't think it's real. You know, I was like, and first of all, like, why don't you give me the 640? Okay. But beyond that. Okay. Cause I have projects going on all the time, you know? But I was like, beyond that, I was like, you've built houses before. Like, do you really think that they're going to be able to go and renovate this place, market it, and get all that done within 90 days? And he's like, now that I'm thinking about it, probably not. And I was like, yeah, I was like, and this, he was like about, I was the last call he made before he sent the wire.
Oh, damn.
You know what I mean? And it's like you look at these people's experience. I looked into them and like, they've raised money from a bunch of other people, especially in like the Gator, you know, I know that they owe one lady like 250, a few other people, but it's like, you really have to do your due diligence. You know what I mean? Especially if you're going to be like lending out, you know what I mean? And it's just like the same thing. You got to do your due diligence on wholesaling. You're like, who are you actually working with? You know what I mean? Cause like in 2023 alone, I won't mention any names, but there's brokers actually like wholesale brokers, you know, how the, like the companies, like, it's not New Western, but it's a company like New Western. You get what I'm saying? Like those little brokerages, one of the general managers there, at a separate entity. I found out like recently that he cut me out of like $20,500 worth of assignments last year.
How?
So the weirdest thing, I was a part of like, I was with Bennett and Sorella at the time. It was BCB Homes. Right. And one of them was like a crazy story. They ended up, it went past the closing date. They didn't sign an extension. Right. But via text and email, everybody was on the same page. It was supposed to close on Friday. We just had to push till Monday. Right. So everybody was on the same page. The broker called our buyer on Saturday and was like, hey, listen, if you guys don't cancel this contract and sell it at this price, like I'm not letting this close. Like straight up told them that. And I have a recorded call on it because I tried to sue these guys for it. Okay. And then they closed on Monday. Tuesday, Wednesday, I'm calling title. I'm like, hey, I'm like, where's my wire? Where's my wire? Like, I need my confirmation of wire, you know? And Monday, Tuesday, they're like, oh, yeah, we'll get it out to you soon. We'll get it out to you soon. And then, like, Wednesday comes. And they're like, oh, well, actually, like, you weren't on this contract. And I was like, so you're telling me that you have the previous contract that I'm on, and now you have the new contract that I'm on, and the money that was supposed to go to me is just going split between two other people. You know what I mean? And there, she was like, yeah, pretty much. And I was like, yeah, I was like, I'm coming for your title policy. I'm coming for everything at that point. And then at the same time, it was like a different buyer, but same guy that we were working with, another house. So one of them was like for 8,400. The other one was for the rest of, the 20,500. And, And I didn't even know that it happened. The way I found out about it was that I'm friends with his partner on Facebook. And when they finished the project and put it on Zillow, like he posted it to Facebook and he was like, oh, look at our new flip that we did. And I texted him, I was like, yo, bro, you told me you didn't buy that house. And he was like, oh, it was a weird situation. The guy put pressure on us, like same exact thing, you know? Yeah. And like the emails even between like our attorneys and their guy, he was like, I would never, you know, screw any, but like, you know, this is my integrity's key and my name and da da da. And I was like, man, like you're a real piece of trash, you know?
Wow.
Yeah. I don't know. It's a crazy world out there, man. You know what I mean? Crazy, crazy. Like, honestly, like that's why I started going towards more like lending and fixing flips, you know, because
I think your big takeaway though is you didn't fix the contracts. I think like at the end of the day, like even though, you know, people go against what they might say verbally, like everything in real estate has to be on paper. If it's not on paper, it's just fairy dust.
100%, you know? And like I said, even all of that stuff, like that was in like the first 3 or 4 months that I was doing this, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So like at this point, I've been through so much like legally, literally like you know, that's happened to me, like everything is buttoned up from like A to Z, you know what I mean? Like I'm not dealing with anything. And like, I rarely actually wholesale anymore. Obviously I still do a bunch of real estate, but I rarely wholesale unless it's like to one of our buddies, you know? But one thing I would love to do is like, if any of you guys even have like luxury buyers, like I have a bunch of, cause I get sent from brokers like off markets all day.
My buddy works for a title company. He owns or he doesn't own it, but he's like the marketing person at Allied Title. They just moved down into Tampa, and I think they're going Miami as well. But he knows like the majority of people he's connecting with are like developers. So if you get anything in Tampa, St. Pete area,
I have a bunch of stuff. Do you remember that the house that I was just telling you about that we're about to lose some money on is so that's a 3.5 purchase price. New build will be 1.2 to 1.5. ARV is like it's like a $4.4 million net profit after lending and resale and everything like that.
Yeah, no, like so they literally like, and I've talked to a couple of them. All they do is buy land and teardowns, and their purchase price, I believe they said, is between like 600 and like 1.5. But they're in that same ball. Like most of their homes are reselling for like 2 to 4 million.
Yeah. We could work some. I mean, let's just get a JV going, bro. Let's just
For sure. I'll talk to him too and get some more info as to exactly where they're buying and what they're looking for, so we can dial in.
I got you. Yeah, just because like obviously like we can't buy everything that we get sent. You know what I mean? So it's like we're trying to hit obviously like one a month. You know what I mean? But still at that, like between raising capital, dealing with all the people, like I'm kind of like, you know, like.
So you know, what do you think, being in the lender space, what do you think about Gator lenders?
I mean, so I'll just put it out there like this, right? Is that I think that it's great, right? I think that it's a risk for the Gator lender, especially like I said, like doing your due diligence, because you don't like it's the whole thing. You don't know the contracts, you don't know the people that you're dealing with, right? But I do think that it's it obviously will help a lot of people. One thing that I don't agree with is like the volume of money that they're providing and the return that they're getting, right? So like let's say that they're going to take like, you know, 10% pref or something like that on their money. That's fine, right? Because that's normal in the industry. But like I've seen deals where it's like, you know, they had to put up 10K EMD, which mind you, they're going to get back, okay? And they'll take 30% of the deal. And if it's like a young kid that just needs some help, you know what I mean? Like there's a reason why it's called Gator, you know what I mean? Like they're fucking, right. You know? So I think like it depends. It's just based off of situation. You know what I mean? Like I personally wouldn't do that. There's no way. Like if a kid had a $20,000-$30,000 wholesale fee, you know what I mean? There's no way that I'm taking a third of that. You know what I mean? At all, ever.
Yeah. I think from and again, I'm just kind of naive to the whole lending side of things, but I think there's a lot of liability on both parties. One, a bank and most lenders, like if you go to a hard money lender or, you know, you go to a bank, or whatever, they're 9 times out of 10, they're not lending you EMD.
No.
You know what I'm saying? And so to go get a loan And like, even if you went to a bank and you were like, hey, I'm trying to get a loan for EMD, they're going to be like, absolutely not. So now we're going outside to a third party to get a loan from someone who's probably unlicensed, who has zero, to your point, they're not even legally allowed to lend money here.
Right.
They're lending you money saying that they're a lender, they're a Gator lender. Yeah. And then, so you're getting funds for something that you technically should have the funds for. Yeah. So now you're getting into a contract, lending EMD, getting EMD lent, and you don't have the resources. You don't have any means to back up anything like that. And then on top of that, the amount of people, to your point, that don't read the contracts, that don't know where EMD goes after it gets closed, that don't know how EMD gets released back. The amount of Gator lenders who don't understand that that litigation could take a while.
Yeah.
And you know, you might not, again, like the 10K that I'm waiting for, it's been 14 months. Imagine if someone had lended 10K on that. It's been 14 months.
I think the system is flawed. Like, it's promoted as like, go get a line of credit and then lend your line of credit. You don't need to know how to do real estate. Just go lend EMD.
Yeah. That's insane. Like, I would never like leverage it. You know what I mean? And also like if you're going to Gator lend your own money, like you have to be on top of your stuff. You have to be looking at the deal. You need to know when inspections are up. Because you got to put some pressure on
the deal. If you don't know,
it's got to be canceled before inspection's done. There's no way, shape, or form that I'm leaving my money in there after inspection if we don't have a buyer.
Well, so that's the crazy thing that doesn't make sense to me is they'll get Gator lenders will have like a contract that they'll like submit to the title company. And it will be like, oh, like it gets canceled before. And then the EMD gets back. It's like, that contract probably means nothing to the title company because they have a legal binding contract between a seller and the buyer. That money is being put up by the buyer in their eyes. They don't care where that money came from to the buyer. So they're like, one, the Gator lender can't cancel the contract. So if that wholesaler is just not organized or if they get in a car accident or something happens and they don't cancel, the Gator lender has no recourse.
Nothing. Nothing. I mean, what are you going to go after? An LLC that probably didn't have anything in it to begin
with. They just borrowed $20,000 from you because they didn't have it. So you're going to sue them for the 10 grand that you lent them?
Yeah. I mean, I think the easiest way to do all this, bro, read Raising Private Capital. You know what I mean? The book that first tells everybody. Read it, bro. So read either like between, you know, chapter 1 to chapter 4 or 6. Okay. And then just throw it away forever. But but like there's so much money out there. There's so much money out there. It's insane. You know what I mean?
This is about the bigger pockets, the raising private capital.
Yeah.
I'll be right back. So keep going.
There's so many people out there that, you know what I mean, that have 401ks or retirement accounts or, you know, anything that they can't touch for another 30, 40 years anyways. Right. So that's what we do. So like, we're going to take the money out in the form of a loan, right? Your yield account was probably making, let's say, 4 to 6%, right? I'm going to put it in this project. You're going to make another 20 to 30% on the money. And then it's going to go back in the account before the end of the year. And then that money adds into it and it just cultivates and compounds, you know, like that's the best way to do it. Like, and you know, your family and friends are going to give you a much better deal than one of these Gator lenders are, to be completely honest. You know? And I think that if you sat them down and explained to them the situation, because the only issue that people will have is like, how is my money secure, right? If everything goes south, how can I regain my money? And if you just have it set out like, hey, you're going to give me this amount, 5,000, 10,000, right? We're going to put it into escrow. And then if we don't have a contract for assignment with EMD replacing yours, 2 days before close, we'll cancel the contract. They'll release EMD and you get your money back, you know? But I think I would, like I told you, I would read that book and I would start reaching out to friends and family before I ever started talking to a Gator lender.
Yeah, no, I don't need, for anyone, even if you're not looking to lend, I need to do more for myself in this regards too. But I mean, if you're making a good amount of money, why not max out your 401k and your IRA? It's not something that you need to do, but if you're making a bunch of money, max it out, because again, to your point, you can borrow against it. And I'm pretty sure it's tax-free if you borrow against it and then put it back in there. I could be wrong.
Not taxable. But the only thing is that you pay interest to yourself technically.
Yeah. So, yeah, but yeah, so like, I definitely need to get more savvy. Well,
what I would say is like, you're obviously a 10 times better candidate to lend out, right, than the average person because of the experiences that you've been through, you know, the knowledge that you have. Like, you're going to rip through that contract. You get what I'm saying? You're going to make sure everything's there. Like, what I don't agree with is people that, you know, pay the $3,000 to $5,000 to get into Gator, and they're trying to lend out within like their first 2 to 3 weeks, you know, like they don't know contracts, they don't know anything, you know, and they just like, they see, you know, a guy on Instagram, you know,
yeah.
And they're like, wow, this seems great. You know, I can make, and if you actually like, I just want to put this out there as well. I'm not saying anything bad about Gator, right? But like, let's say that you do charge a 10% pref and then you take 30% of the deal, right? If an attorney gets a hold of that, like, there's a chance that, I mean, I'm not speaking based off of knowledge, but just based off of logic, right? You can get in trouble for that for sure, because that's predatory lending at the end of the day. You know what I mean? Like, you're not allowed to exceed anywhere. I think it's like 15 or 18% in the United States. And like, so it would come down to the contract based off of the interest. And then maybe it's a JV as well. Like, that's one situation where I could see it working. But like, if you're from the outside looking in, if you're taking a pref plus profit share, like, that's predatory, 100%.
Yeah.
And also,
I've always been to your point. I'm like, rather than Gator lending, just JV with them.
Yeah,
100%. Because once you do that, like, in my eyes, it's like, if you JV with them, one, you can now go on the contract. Hey, look, I'm happy to lend the EMD to you, but I either need to be the purchaser on this, or yeah, it needs to be your name and my name on the contract. So if for whatever reason I need to back out and you're not around, I can send that notification or that notice and we're good. Yeah. Like, yeah. And then at that point, to your point, even if you take 50%, I think it's justified. If you don't have 10 grand and you're asking someone for 10 grand and they're asking for 50%, JV with them, like, yeah, and let them take that risk and let them eat that same risk that you are for the same amount of money. You don't have the 10 grand. You need them to close the deal. So break bread together and then get your EMD that way.
Yeah. Or give grandma a good return, you know, who knows? Yeah,
right.
Figure it out, man. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. Like, I don't know. Like, long story short, you guys know the backstory about, you know, how all these operations run, you know what I mean? And like they're giving out the information, especially on Gator, you know what I mean? But like, their primary goal is to build membership. You know what I mean? Is to build that revenue stream, you know? So it's like, yeah, it's like, you know, just because you have that community there, right, and you have an MSA that you can call once a week that probably doesn't know what they're talking about to begin with, you know, it's like, you're the one that's taking a risk. You're the one that's taking a risk, you know? So, yeah, you know, so.
Entry, you know, obviously it's going to be less good people. It's too easy. Like, the way that I see it, and I think Gator is a valuable resource to have, but just how low of a barrier to entry. You have a bunch of really crappy Gators out there. Like, I could literally count, and it would probably be about like 7 out of 10 people in my phone that have stated themselves as a Gator can't tell what a deal is or isn't. And I could go to them and I could ask them for money, and they would probably just give me money just because of my social following, not even 100%. Check the deal, not even check the contract, nothing. And yeah, that's, in my opinion, that's not a good Gator. I mean, that's great for me because I can source money pretty easily, yeah, but that's not a good Gator. You got to know 100%. What a deal is. You got to know what the contracts are. You got to protect yourself.
Yeah. They should just go to the casino, you know?
Dude, I made a post saying that I needed $12,000 for EMD. I had one person reach out to me. If you're watching, say hi in the comments. This person reached out to me. He's like, dude, I just want to do a deal with you. I'm going to give you the EMD. I won't charge you anything. We don't have to put it on paper. Like, where can I wire it? I'm like,
geez, that's terrible. That's rough. Yeah.
I'm going to pass. Thank you, but I'm going to pass.
Whoever that was, shout out for the support, but that is the most irresponsible financially decision you could ever make.
Yeah.
Don't do that again.
You got to have a contracted promissory note, like everything, joint agreement, JV, whatever you want to do. Make sure it's on, everything's on paper, man. Everything's and also for your protection as well. You know what I mean? Like, that's like for both sides, you know, like that's why contracts are put in place. You know,
I like it just for the most important aspect of it to me is just to maintain relationships. We don't want misunderstandings, right? So we want something clearly outlined in paper. I have people that I can do business with that will literally drop money like that just on trust. But like, it's like, I don't want that. I want a contract so that we both fully understand what we're getting into, because I value the relationship more than the one transaction.
Yeah, 100%. 100%. And also, you want to connect it to entities and not personal, just so you know. Like, you know, that's a big thing right there. I'm not taking 12 grand in my in any account without any contract. You know what I mean?
Yeah. All right. Well, guys, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Big show. This was really, really good. Ryan, you are one of the best episodes for sure.
Thank you. I appreciate it, man. We had a lot to talk about, man. And it worked out. It was like organic, you know, like we both went through it together and we're getting it figured out. Hopefully it will be, it'll be solved this year, and we'll have to do an update or something like that. You know?
Yeah. So just curious if, like, again, knock on wood, and I don't think this is going to happen by any means, but like, it sounds like everything is working in your favor. If for whatever odd reason things go left, like, are you all responsible for the 25k attorney fees, and then they go after the party and charge them, or like, how does that ultimately work?
We've paid 20, like, rough, just north of 25k so far.
So like, you've out of your pocket have paid 25 right. grand so, and then so once the it closes, if it wins, then they go after the correct. Other party for the 25 grand,
right? Yeah. Yeah. So here's the kicker, right? Is that it's not like there's no situation where we don't lose it, right? Like, either two things will happen. We will either get the house or we'll get the title insurance policy. Now, the one negative thing about the title insurance policy is that, like, it's up to interpretation, right? So like, at that point, it's another situation where we have to, like, go back and forth. 'Cause you know, they're going to offer us like a penny, you know? And then we're going to be like, hey, we won $350,000, because that's, you know, everything accumulated. And then, you know, it'll go back and forth, and we'll figure it out at that point. But like, the main goal is that we want the house, right? And like, one of the weird things is, like I said, that, like, as of right now, it's a completely different family living in there. You know what I mean? So like, we have this crazy story. We don't even know their side of the story. You know what I mean? Like, there's a chance that he lied to the new owners of the home, technically. You get what I'm saying? They paid him a certain portion of money and put it into a trust. And you know what I mean? Like, it's absolute mess. And now we have to call this lady and we're like, hey, we want your house. You know, after, like, there's a good chance that they probably already did a renovation to the house.
Before
they found out about the lawsuit. You know what I mean? They probably went in and fixed everything. Like, who knows, you know? But like, it's so my
there's house. Probably a good chance if they did, there's it. I would almost be willing to bet that the house is going to stay with them. And then, like, whoever is in the house, more than likely. So like, how we had a similar situation, and the attorney was basically telling me, they're like, hey, like, when court cases go to like if the house has already been kind of like transferred, or, you know, I guess sold in a way,
we'd have to pay the difference. Like,
yeah. So they're like, normally it will be a monetary value, because they're like, nine times out of 10, it's damn near impossible to get that sale of the house back to you, basically.
Yeah. So essentially what would happen is we would have to pay whatever the contract price is, and we would also have to reimburse them for, you know, the repairs or whatever that they can prove that they repaired during that time, which, like, we had a 40K rehab budget anyways. You know what I mean?
So it's like, yeah, exactly.
So no problem, you know?
That makes sense.
But
because we had a similar situation, but it was like two buyers fighting over whose assignment was whose. And like, it was the dumbest situation, but like, one of them was saying that they were going to sue the other one for the house. And the attorney was like, bro, like, the house was already sold. The dude owns it. Like, that, nine times out of 10, it's not going to revert. But to your point, what you just explained makes a lot of sense, where it's like, okay, well, here's the contract price. Here's the amount of rehab.
Right.
Figure it out monetarily.
So like, the way, because like, we've had that conversation, right? So like, we already asked them, we're like, listen, like, we'll take the title insurance, right? But unless it's at a certain figure, right? So like, if they come back and they're like, hey, we're only going to do $100,000, like, we're going to go full force for the house, like, whether anybody likes it or not. And because of the fact that we had the first contract, we have the list pendants, we also have all the communications and everything, like, he blatantly did something that was illegal, whether it was to his knowledge or not, that's none of my problem. You know what I mean? Right, so like, right. To be honest, the worst part is that like these people that do live there now, like could potentially be in a situation to where they have to move. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And, right. Like screw the dude who's putting everyone in this situation. The people that are in this situation that have no idea what's going on. They're like, I didn't sign up for this shit.
And I mean, but to their point, like me and like Nathan and you know, Nathan and I and Titus, like we're all in the same boat. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like no one always, signed up for it. It's between the agent and the seller. You know what I mean? All this stuff just kind of happened and we're problem solvers. So we tried to get it figured out, but it is what it is, you know?
Yeah.
So, I'll send you a selfie when I get it. I promise.
Yeah. Yeah, you definitely need a selfie out front of it after it closes.
100%. You'll have to fly out with the whole legal team behind everybody involved. Yeah. It's like a football team. Like,
dude, that would be hilarious.
But one thing I have learned is like I avoid legal at all costs. I swear to God, people like if you guys are like watching and stuff, like you know, people think it's fun to like you know threaten and do all that. Like, stay away from legal. It is the worst thing that you could even if you win, nobody wins. Nobody wins. You know what I mean? The stress. The lawyers win. You know what I mean? But
who wants to pay a lawyer $25,000 to have them only win?
Yeah. For them. Yeah.
I don't know. Right. Literally no one, like you said, it's like you get dragged to court. You got to
Think about it this way. Like, let's say we kick these people out of their new house. Right. Like the chances of them pouring concrete down the septic and all that, like this house is going to be trash by the time that we get it for sure. You know? Mm-hmm. So it's like, it's just like, there's so many different factors and ways to go about it. You know what I mean? Like, there might not be a house there anymore. You know what I mean? By the time that we get, it might just be vacant land, you know, who knows?
That's honestly why. That's why there's like mediation and arbitration and stuff. Cause they're like, bro, like, let's try to get this resolved before we even
go through this process. So let's say that we do get it resolved and like we have to buy them out of the house. Right. That there's nothing in any contract ever that says that they have to deliver it. It's an as-is contract, right? So they have to deliver it in like the same shape. So like legally, like they could trash the place and we have no recourse no matter what, you know? And that was one of the main things going into it originally is we were trying to get this thing closed up before this guy got out of jail because I was like, this guy's going to burn this thing to the ground. Yeah. Close, you know, for sure, you know? So, Damn. Yeah. But yeah. I don't know. Just crazy, crazy, crazy times. You know, we're all just trying to make a couple dollars, you know.
I was going to say real estate, you can make a lot of money, but you also can deal with a lot of headaches.
Oh, you're going to deal with the most amount of stress you've ever dealt with in your life.
And in all honesty, the reason being, like I've noticed this and I think anyone who's been in real estate for a couple of days can attest to this. It is the most ego driven industry.
Yeah.
I've ever been a part of. Like everyone wants to be right. In real estate, everyone has money to be right in real estate. And so it's just ego battles 24/7 with everyone trying to be the right person.
Yeah. I mean, everybody just wants to be a big investor. You know what I mean? And it's like, let's be real here. You know what I mean? Like if somebody came to you and you know, they're being exactly like egotistical, you know, and like, as you get into it, like they've probably never taken title to a house. They've probably never, you know what I mean? Like they've never done a fix and flip. They probably haven't done any of it. You know what I mean? But like it's, you know, something that goes into their mind that like with this job, like you have to be an investor.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like some of the most successful wholesalers in the country, like they're blatant about being a wholesaler. You know what I mean? They're like, because they can go in and they can kind of talk to the sellers like, hey, you know, we really do have a few different ways to exit, you know? And you know, like novations are getting actually really big right now, you know, so that's like there's a bunch of different ways to skin a cat, you know, but
interesting too though with novations, because I heard and I don't know if this is true, I can't remember if it was Tony, one of the big people that it might be either Tony Mont, I don't know if it was Tony Mont, Eric Klein, or I think it might be Eric. One of the two, and again, I don't know. So by all means, if it's one of y'all and I'm butchering this and I'm getting it incorrect, don't come after me. But I heard from someone that one of the gurus that's really pushing the novation side of things also is like drowning in novation lawsuits.
Oh shoot.
Like that's they crazy. Have like
so what, like I wanna, non-performance?
Like just a whole bunch of stuff, like non-performance, repairs going sideways, the property not selling the right way. God. Like I've heard that like literally he's really pushing novations and like 60% of them turn into lawsuits. Like
I know Tony Mont's been pushing novations on social media. Not saying
his I don't name know up, if it's him. Yeah, I don't know if it's either, him. You know, because so, there's a bunch of people pushing it.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, I heard
that's crazy. I didn't even think about that. Imagine doing a novation, renovating somebody's home, and like the contractor just completely messed up, and they're like, "Oh, well, yeah, right." Sorry.
So think of like so the contractor. We've all heard of horror stories where the contractors just don't come back, and it's burned now, right? So that could happen. People forget that homeowners love to be in control of their property.
Yeah.
So if you, even if it's on paper, if you go in there and you knock out the kitchen wall and they had another vision, now you're dealing with the homeowner in the way of saying, no, 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 we're not doing this. We're going to do it my way. So now you have to sue because you have the, like, there's a lot of mess with renovating someone's house and reselling it or whatever you do. You know, there's multiple ways you can do novations, but I've just heard that there's a lot of lawsuits that people get involved in. So you just want to make with anything in real estate, know your contracts, just make sure you know what the hell you're getting into.
Yeah. 100%.
So I guarantee you it's the people who don't know or don't read it that have the contracts being, or the lawsuits popping up and they're like,
and read the contracts. Like the more contracts you read, the better you're going to get at reading them. You know what I mean? I'm willing to bet that there's a good amount of people out there, right, that cannot find, like inspection period. Do you get what I'm saying? Contract? Like your inspection period clause. I'm willing to bet that like there's a majority of people that like couldn't find the first try on a contract. They'd have to scroll through a few times. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. Dude, you know, one thing that I really like is whenever I come across an unfamiliar contract, I upload it to ChatGPT and I ask it to like break it down section by section and explain every part. ChatGPT is like essentially a $20 a month lawyer. And
I feel
like ChatGPT can be better than most human lawyers because it just has a more vast knowledge base, more critical thinking skills.
Yeah.
I mean, I always tell people at the end of the day, like as much as it sucks and as much as no one's an attorney, like read the contract at least once before you sign something. Yeah. Like, I don't care if you're going through it and you're like, what the hell is this talking about? At least read it, because again, knowing the little discrepancies from Virginia, I need to have an inspection report. DC and Maryland, it just needs to be a buyer inspects it. Knowing those two things could literally have your EMD tied up or not. So,
And also like you probably know some other wholesalers there, like have conversations, you know what I mean? Before you start doing that area, like, hey, people like to help people, you know what I mean? Like, so it's like, hey, just ask them like, hey, what have you dealt with in the past? You know what I mean? That I could kind of look out for, you know, like that's the whole reason why we're here, you know? So
yeah, facts,
you know, like literally, you know, it's to help each other. So, you know, but yeah, but wild ride, my friend.
For sure. All right. Well, let's wrap up the show. So, guys, thank you so much for sticking with us. I did see a whole bunch of happy birthdays in the comment section.
Yeah, happy birthday. I forgot. Yeah. I saw it when I was on the way here, bro. Or it's my
thank
house.
Thank you, dude. Thank you. Dude, there's so many people here in the comment section that said happy birthday. I followed you guys. Thank you. I appreciate that. 23 is what I've turned now.
Atta boy.
Hey. I have some sticky stuff on me still.
There you go.
Well, thank you so much. Ryan, how do people get a hold of you? Like what kind of target audience are you looking for and how do they reach out to you?
Well, so one thing I'm looking to do is, like I said, getting rid of some of those high-end deals, right? So if you guys actually have, or anybody that's watching, if you guys have luxury buyers who can produce a POF, and actually like experience, right? I have a bunch of deals between Florida, California, and New Jersey, that like we just can't do, you know. I probably get sent like 20 off markets a month, and like I said, like we're going to do one of them, you know? So, from a cash flow standpoint, like I would love to start getting rid of these. Okay. And number two is just like lending as well. Like anybody that needs lending on a fix and flip or a rental or anything like that, hit me up, because my company's right there, KPRE Capital Group. You can Google us, look at the website, you see my handsome face on there, and we can get some deals done.
Awesome, dude.
Oh yeah, let's do it.
Yes, thanks, sir. Jacob, for being an awesome co-host.
Thank you guys. Thank you both. Truly.
Yeah, thank you also as well.
Adios, guys.
Peace. All right, later.